Here we go again. The last stream was like 5 months ago. Oh no. Not my voice. Anyhow, I have shorter hair, so that's something. And yeah, we are going to study music history. Or not actually study, I guess it's just like practicing. So the thing is, most of the time when I would like have a test or when I would like write a like paper, I would like make a stream either to practice, like when I had presentations, like my presentation on Verbunko and stuff. Oh yeah, my voice is probably quiet. I do have like a thing here called the equalizer APO, but I guess it doesn't properly work right now. Test. Yeah, it's still quiet. Oh well. I won't really play any like YouTube videos anyway, so you might have to like fear that your ears are gonna be blown out whenever I play a video, because you've cranked up your volume because of me. So here we are again to practice music stuff for my studies. So next Wednesday I have an oral exam. I've already like finished my bachelor's paper. Not sure if or when I'm going to present it. Since it's kind of connected to another project that me and a few colleagues are working on. So you might like work on it at a later point. And I might like present it sometime later, someday. But I can tell you the topic. My bachelor's paper was on how to cite video game music as a source in a like scientific paper, in a ludomusicological paper. Like stuff like, what do you have to indicate? Like, for example, you should tell what region the version you're playing is from, because like, for example, what's it called? Let's say Mega Man X3, on the PlayStation 1. It was released in like Japan with like Japanese pop song as an intro track, while in America or in Europe it was released with an instrumental intro song. So the music is different depending on which region the game you're playing is from. So stuff like that. Anyhow, combined with the bachelor's paper is an oral exam. It's not about the bachelor's paper. It's about like 15 minutes talking about some random topic that you choose yourself. It should be kind of like detached from your bachelor's paper topic. Like my bachelor's paper, like time-wise, my bachelor's paper is like more like modern, hyper-modern even, because like, well, video games are pretty modern. So I chose the exact opposite. Russian neumes in Russian church music. Neumes, by the way, if you don't know what those are, let me actually show you a picture of like some Western neumes. You will see some of Russian neumes as well, obviously. Nope. Yeah. Okay, there you go. It is pretty small. Let's see if we can find a bigger picture. That kind of stuff, where you have like the song text, and over the song text you have like these signs that are like a rough indication. It's just for memorization purposes. So you can just quickly remember what this means, like how you are supposed to sing. So this is like a rough melody line that these signs are indicating. Russian gnomes, indeed. So yeah, that kind of stuff. Oh, here I am again. Anyhow, so this is like in the range of the, in regards to Russian music at least, 11th until the 18th century. which is a pretty big range, but it's still older than the 20th century or 21st century with video game music. Russian gnomes. Let's see. How do we start? The other 15 minutes. I should probably mention that as well. The first 15 minutes is me talking about Russian gnomes. Russian gnomes. And the other 15 minutes will be like random questions about music history. They can be rough, or they could maybe be more like specific. What I've been told is that they might like give me a range like 16th century, and then I'm supposed to talk about something random, about music history in general during the 16th century. Like, I guess I would, for example, talk about the Council of Trient, which was like this church music get together where the people were like, oof, the music in church music right now is like, it sucks because the music is becoming more polyphonic, meaning the text is harder to understand, but we want the text to be easy to understand in church music. Or we want that, there's less like worldly influences in the music, like less folk song references in our church music. It should be like pure, just churchy music. No world music influences, stuff like that. Or I guess it could be more specific, because one colleague of mine was actually asked about the Notre Dame epoch, which is like the 13th century, and like it was like one of the big parts of like in the history of multi-voice church music. They even they adapted a new type of notation where they used square note notation, I guess is what it could be translated to, which is pretty much this. Looks pretty much like this, but they added extra features so that there's a rhythm. That way, this would, in the old style, this would just indicate the where the notes would go, what the melody line is, more exact. Here you have a rough indication of how the melody kind of progresses. Here you have actual lines where you can see how high or low you have to go when singing this. And then additionally, they also added a rhythm, so you could say, okay, this is that amount long, a quarter or half note length, stuff like that. Okay, I'm getting ahead of myself though. I guess what I would need some help with later on, after my 15-minute presentation on Russian gnomes, is you can ask me some random century, and I will try to talk about it for a bit, and hopefully something will. I remember something about that century. You have probably seen the thumbnail. It's just that guy in the meme game going "Guess I'll die." That will probably be my face during the oral exam, when they are when they ask me about the 11th century or whatever. Another thing to note, I have my notes here, so I have a script that I've written, so I can learn it by heart, including some pictures that I will show you. They're probably more from this document. But I have to do everything by heart, so I can't actually read this off, unfortunately. I also have random notes, including pictures. I guess I can use these to show you a few pictures, what the stuff I'm talking about looked like, at least roughly. Yeah, pretty much. I have a book here. Make sure you get it. I have two books even. europäische Musikgeschichte in Schlaglichtern. That's German for European European music in, like, I guess, spotlights, thingies. Like, it just has, like, short articles on different stuff from, like, European music history. And it's 500 pages long. So I have to remember 500 pages somehow. Though the thing is, I'm skipping the 20th century. So, because I won't have enough time. I still have like 50 or 30 pages left to read until Wednesday and somehow to remember. And additionally, Mutationskunde, 10th century to 20th century, which is like a notation, I guess, theory, which has like another 300 pages of, well, notation history. So yeah, this I have to remember 800 pages somehow. So yeah, wish me luck. Anyhow, let's get to the Russian neumes. I've already lost like 2 viewers because music history is pretty boring probably. Anyhow, yeah, let's leave this. Actually, you know, I might need the document so I can show you stuff. Okay, let me start with Russian neumes. So that's like my main topic for the oral exam. I guess the thing is that there are 5 types of neumes actually in Russian music, 5 important types. There were like different like minor types that like came about like really quickly and then disappeared, and there's like barely any research done on them anyways, but there are 5 main types that do have like more research done on them and that are featured more prominently in like Russian neumes sources. So there's the egg phonetic, they're the egg phonetic neumes or notation, egg phonetic notation. That lasts from the 11th century to the 16th century. So this was one of the first ones adapted in Russian church music. There's the Kondakarian notation that lasts from the 12th to the 14th century. There's the Stolp notation, which is the most important one, which lasts from the 12th to the 17th century. So it was around the longest, actually. There's the Puch notation, which lasted from which came about at around the 16th century. And then there's the domestic notation, the domestic notation, there we go, which lasted from about the 16th to the 18th century. It's actually a graph here kind of indicating this stuff. And the Stolp notation actually splits off into 3 different types of like Stolp notation, A, B, and C. I will go through each of them really quickly. Like roughly, I also for most of them I won't show any pictures because there aren't really any easily findable pictures of them. But yeah, let's start with the egg phonetic notation, which was, like I said, one of the earliest. So the egg phonetic notation was directly like adapted from the like Greek Byzantine. Ah, the difference between each notation. I will get to that. That's a good question. Actually, before I get to the notation, let me give you a bit of a historical context. The thing is that Russia has a big like connection to the Byzantine church. So not like the Western church, like Rome and stuff, but Byzantine instead. So the thing is that around 988, Russia was Christianized. They got like... and even before that, they got like 2 monks to translate the like the Bible into Slavic, into the Slavic language. And those monks were from Byzantine. Welcome back, Patrick. So they were from Byzantine, right at the edge of the Slavic like area of the map. And they knew Slavic and they knew the Byzantine tradition, and they translated it to Slavic. So even back in the 9th century, Russia had a connection to Byzantine, to the Byzantine church. And so they also adapted like different like types of songs and their like church music repertoire to some degree from Byzantine. But one thing that should also be mentioned, like historical wise, is also that Russia was invaded by the Mongols quite a lot, like especially in the 13th century there was a pretty big like invasion, but also later the invasions lasted until the 15th century at the very least. So Russia during those times could either not produce any sources on Russian church music, or like it was like more limited in regards to the production, and it's and they some sources were also destroyed, like by the Mongols. So this means that the sources between the 12th century and the, or the 13th century and the 15th century are also kind of limited, and there were the connection to Byzantine was also weakened during that time. Like Russia was a bit of like rather isolated because of the Mongol invasions. So that's a difficulty with the sources. As regarding sources, there are two important types of sources for Russian neumes. There are the azbuki, which can roughly be translated to alphabets, which had like, well, mostly really rough descriptions or really, well, bad, inconclusive descriptions of neumes, or sometimes just the names of the neumes, but they were there. So there were books with neumes. And the dvoje znameniki, which means like something like the two, they had two types of signs in them, meaning they had like different types of neumes. So if you knew what one type of neume meant, you could translate the other type of neume as well. Actually, let me see if I forgot anything important. Nope. Okay, ekphonetic notation. So that one was directly adapted from the Byzantine Greek tradition of church music. And yeah, it was mostly used by like for people reading the script, the Holy Script, meaning that it was like, it was kind of singish, like people sang in the church, like when they read from the Bible, because that that way the voice traveled farther. Like they didn't have a microphone back then, obviously. So by singing the text, people could actually more easily understand the text rather than if they just read the text normally. So it was mostly used by what it was called, actually I have to look it up, lectors and liturgs. Oh yeah, a question would be really appreciated, of course, that way I can make sure that I have all the necessary info in my presentation. So yeah, like I said, those were directly adapted from Greek Byzantine tradition, but eventually Russian neumes got a bit more independent from Greek and Byzantine, from the Greek and Byzantine traditions. So the next one would be the Kondakari notation. I actually want to show you what it looks like. Do I have like a, well, I guess this picture kind of depicts them, but I want to have a more practical one. Let's see if there's like a good picture of Kondakari notation. Doesn't seem like it. Like there's a book that I'm using that has them. Let's see. I have to open a PDF. Maybe this one. Like they look really wacky. There we go. There's the Kondakari notation. Hi June, what's up? We're in the right spirit, right Russian spirit here. So as you can see, there were like two lines in the Kondakari notation. There's like up here, like this one is theorized to be like chironomic signs, chironomic meaning that's it likely depicts hand signs, like meaning that people, when they like there was one front singer who taught the others the melody, and to help them like know which notes to hit, like if they had to go higher or lower, they would use their hand and be like da 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 da, stuff like that. And it's possible that these signs meant to show these hand movements. Then there's another line down here, which is likely used for clarifying, like how exactly the notes like are supposed to sound. But the Kandakari notation is pretty like under research, meaning that there have been attempts at deciphering it. I think there's actually one attempt here. Here you go. But you have like multiple signs that just show one note. So it's kind of inconclusive. But the theory is that the Kandakari notation was used for like more complex music, because at the same time there existed a stop notation, which I will get to right now, which was like the most important type of notation. First about the name though. So if you read up about the stop notation, there are three different names for it. Stop notation, Znamenaya notation, and Kryuki notation. So why did I choose stop notation? I guess things can become pretty confusing because different scholars use different names for that type of notation. One scholar had a pretty like logical explanation why they use stop notation though, so I adapted that. I think this is what the stop notation looked like, by the way. So they didn't opt for using Znamenaya notation because Znamenaya or Znamenaya just means sign, and it's just a general term that could be used for different kinds of notation as well, because those are all sign notations because they use signs, obviously, even the Kandakari notation. And the Kryuki notation they didn't use. Kryuki was adapted from the main type of sign that the stop notation used. Like here, these thingies, like Kryuki just means hook. So this looks like a hook here. The problem is that multiple types of notation use these hooks as well, which we'll get to later. Like the Puch notation and the domestic notation used these Kryuks as well. Kryuki. That's why I opted for using the stop notation instead. Question should be, I guess best would be to ask questions at the very end, so I can like just get through all of this first, and maybe some questions will be answered through the course of the presentation, and then I can get to the questions that weren't answered at the end, and that way I can have a better grasp on the time, since it's not like I have 15 minutes to talk about this, though I guess in this case it would be more like 25 minutes or 20 minutes, because I have to speak in English and I have to like somehow translate on the fly, because my script is written in German and I've learned to like present it in German. So the thing with stop notation is there are three different types of notation, as I have shown here. Was it here? No, it was here. Stop C, B, and A. And I'm not sure why it's in reverse order. I'm not sure why the earliest isn't just called stop A, but I guess that's just how it is. So stop A was the one that was around for the longest time. Or like pretty much always until the 17th century. Or 18th century. Even apparently according to this graph, though not according to another source that I have read. But this is a bit of an older source after all. So stop notation, like I already showed, looked like this, had like these different signs. The interesting thing about the stop notation was that it's actually, as opposed to other types of neumes in the like Western church music, actually showed exactly how long the notes were. Let me actually show you. Let's see if you have that here. Here, for example. I just noticed, are these like reverse crooks? Oh no, it's just like this part is elongated for some reason. Okay, it's all good. No worries. Here, for example, the crook would be exactly like, it could be translated to half a note. And the crooks sotsekoi would be a quarter note. So opposed to other systems in the Western music, like in Western church music, you had exact rhythms here, which was pretty interesting. As we go towards the 17th century, especially the 17th century, other like variations of the Greek notation come up. Let's go back up. Here we go. You start around the 17th century here, stop B and stop A notation. So the stop B notation is came about because there was more of a like drive towards knowing exactly which notes should be sung, because here you actually like, just like in the Western church notation, you had no idea what the exact note heights were. Like the problem in Western church notation was also that some scholars would sing some singers in some like areas would sing the same like song differently than others in other regions, because these neumes were just really rough indications. They didn't tell you which notes exactly to sing. They just told you the rough roughly how the melody went. And in this case, they at least showed you also like how long each note to sing, or each syllable to sing. So around the 17th century, people did want to have like more exact indications on which notes were supposed to be sung. And so one monk, Ivan Scheidur was his name, invented the Kinovarne Pomieti, which was like, which means like Zenobar, like remember signs, I guess, could be translated as. So these were like red letters that were attached to the neumes, and then told the singer like exactly what note they were referring to. Like the system was split into like thirds, from I believe G to G2. Let's see, actually it should be in here. So G, no, G to G2, that way. So there were like four like sections, the like simple, darker, bright and very bright sections. So you had three notes in each section, and each of those notes had a sign. Or like a letter combination, or a letter, like in this case GN. Though these are like Western letters. They of course used Kyrillic letters instead of these. So if there was a GN with a plus in front of it, next to a neum, you knew that this was the exact note that had to be sung. Let me show you in practice how this looked like. Here you go. Okay, I can't properly zoom in, but you can see like red letters around these, and these red letters indicated which notes had to be sung. They also additionally, at a later point, they also added stuff like other indications, like how fast these parts had to be sung, or with which expression they had to be sung as well. But I don't know much about those, unfortunately. Like none of the sources I looked at really went into detail on those parts, only on how the like these red marks indicated the exact height. of the notes. So yeah, let's see, make sure I didn't forget anything. Yeah, I think this was the most important about the stop C, stop B notation. And then we get to the stop A, which was another like branch off from the stop B notation. The thing is that like these signs are in red, and like which century was it? Around the 15th? When did people start printing? Wikipedia, please tell me. I thought it was like the 15th century, but I'm not sure. It doesn't want to tell me. Anyone know by heart when printers became a thing? Like not electrical printers, but actually like Druck is like printing, the direct translation of that. Yeah, it was the 15th century. Okay, with Gutenberg. Oof. Okay, there we go. So yeah, the thing is that the Russian printeries couldn't really handle the two-color printing that well, which was a problem because you had these creaky in red and black, and then those Kinovarne Pomieti in red. So you had two different kinds of colors. So what they did instead is invent Priznaki, which were like these like thingies added to the notes. Let's see if I have a picture. Probably not. Oh yeah, there we go. So you had these lines added to the notes, so it could be either like no line or in the middle or at the top, or in this case like no line at left, at the right, and this would indicate which note was supposed to be like played or sung rather. So this way you had like a totally black layout, because you could print these like neumes in in black. And you can print these like thingies at these like lines in black as well. In practice, there was like more of a combo, because like usually these Priznaki were used as well as the Kinovarne Pomieti in the end, like in combination. So yeah, yeah, that's pretty much it for the stop notation. So there are these three types of notation. The split off in the 17th century. And then we get to the Pucci notation, which was like came about in the 16th century. Like around the up until the 17th century, most of the, like if not all, of the singing in Russian church music was monophonic, meaning that it was like just one voice and everyone followed that voice or played like octave parallels. So it was pretty much just one melody line. But around the 17th century, specifically, people started singing in like with multiple voices, or even like there were like at the at around the 16th century even, or in this case, it says that even in the 15th century, it came about at the end of the 15th century. The Pucci notation was used for this like multi-voice singing. You had three lines. You had the Pucci, which like means like the way, the like main voice in the middle in red. Then you had two different voices in black, at the one at the bottom, one at the top, and they would like be used to accentuate specific sections in like fourth or fifth parallels. And then you had the domestic notation a bit later, which also technique came about in the 16th century, lasted until the 18th century, which was mainly used for the domestic singing. So just like the Puch notation, and the domestic notation both borrowed signs from the Stolp notation, but also added new signs or added new meanings to these signs from the Stolp notation. Like I said, the Puch and the domestic notation do also feature crooks, for example, like these signs here. There you go. These like hooks. And yeah, the domestic notation was used for the domestic singing, which was a certain type of singing. It was like a more complicated form of singing. It went beyond the eight tone system of the Stolp notation. Like the eight tone system, I mean, this one's a bit like more complicated to explain to non-music peeps. I guess church music had like eight type of modes. That's what they were called. You might have heard of like Dorian, Lydian, Mixolydian, Phrygian. So you had also like the church type of like scales, the church scales, you could say. And that domestic singing went like beyond the system of the like these church scales, and it was more complicated. And the domestic notation was used for that. So if anyone ever asks you why was the domestic notation invented when they already had Stolp notation, it's because the domestic notation was more complicated and went beyond this eight tone system of the Stolp notation. All right, and that's all of these notation types. I guess I will have to look at the clock when I'm like, depending on how much time I've left, I will also, during that oral exam, I'll also talk about the keyword notation as a like future thing, like what came after the neumes. And one thing I could mention as well, like I talked about how important the Stolp notation was because it was like around the longest, as you can see. It's actually, as these lines indicate, it's actually still in use by the old believers in Russia. The old believers are a group of religious people in Russia who want to stick to the old traditions, old religious traditions. And so they also use the Stolp notation, usually Stolp B, possibly also Stolp A. So they still sing from neumes, actually still today. But church music in Russia actually already adapted this like more, like they went away from these neumes and signs and went towards quadratic notation, also called Kiever notation or Kiev notation. Let me show you what quadrat notation looked like. You actually already saw it. So this is what it looked like. So they adapted this from the Western music. Like in the West, this type of notation was already around in the 13th century. So then finally, at the end of the 17th century, Russia adopted this kind of notation as well. It originally came to the Ukraine. Like at first, Ukraine adapted this style, and then from Ukraine, it came to Russia. So yeah, and this way it would be like even easier to depict like which notes exactly had to be sung. I'm not showing it. There you go. Now you can actually see it. So yeah, I'm talking about this type of notation that they adapted at the end of the 17th century. So yeah, and this was actually still mainly used just for monophonic singing, meaning just singing with one voice. If there were multiple voices present, then I believe they might have still used stuff like the Puch notation or maybe the Stolp notation. But I'm not 100% sure on that. Okay, this would technically be the end of my presentation. It took like half an hour, but since I'm translating on the fly and showing off stuff, which I won't be doing in the actual presentation, I think this should be okay. But I will be practicing it even more anyway, so I can stop the time some more and see if I have to get rid of some parts. Okay. hit me with your questions. I heard you have a lot of questions, Alfred. And let me drink something. Gotta hydrate. I think I need to sneeze because of hay fever again. So I didn't forget anything important. Was another interesting notation kind, actually. Show you real quick. No, actually it's not here. But yeah, there was actually another type of notation that was invented by the old believers as well. But it wasn't neumes either. So I won't really be talking about that anyways. Okay, are neumes effective? Why? So the thing is that back then, the oral tradition was like the strongest. Like the oral tradition was strong back then, so songs were taught through oral tradition. These neumes were invented just so that people could more easily like remember these songs. So it was still like mainly learn this by heart, and this is just used for remembering. Like you couldn't learn any like how to sing this song just with these neumes. That's the problem. But the advantage of neumes is that it shows actually like song like the melody line more roughly. Or like, okay, so the thing is, let me show you what a graphic from here. Here we go. Let's see. So I should be able to see this. Actually, let me just switch to the webcam. Okay, there you go. So on the right, you have what it would look like in like our notation right now. So this would mean that like whenever you have a note, it would just jump up to that note. When in reality, what they actually want to sing looked more like this on the left. Or right, left, I'm not sure, like what I'm pointing at. I think it should be left from your point of view. So this was a like this square notation could have like technically was a misrepresentation of what the singing actually looked like. So it didn't just jump up to this note, it would the melody line would be marked like the I can't sing, but it would be more rough. So that was the advantage of these neumes. Like they actually like they didn't misrepresent the like how it was actually supposed to be sung. But the disadvantage is of course that it couldn't depict or that it wouldn't depict the exact height of those notes, so you couldn't actually learn to play or to sing using just this notation. So yeah, I hope that answered your question. And eventually it became more important for people to know what exact hates to sing. But back then it was like more important to represent it like properly, like to make sure that people sang it like in the way that it was supposed to be sung, with a like less static melody line. How were the notations taught to the next generation? I would believe mostly for practice. Like people would get these like they would have these books, like usually they would have this huge book. I can actually show it on camera, but it would be like huge, so that it would be put on a pedestal like a few feet away, and they would like look at it, and people who then were at that church, like they were monks usually, oftentimes, or I don't know, they were like employed at the church. They were actually like employed singers at the church. And then there would be one guy, maybe it would be the cantor, was that in English? Cantor, I guess, the choir master. And he would teach them to sing these. So, like I said, they would, for example, use their hand signs and be like, okay, now sing like around here, then you go down, and it would sound roughly like this, like he would sing it, and they would then have to sing it along, and they would have to remember that singing. And then they would have like these signs as rough indication so they could remember it better, or don't have to learn by heart as much as they would have to otherwise. So yeah, they usually learned it at the like, with the help of a choir master at the church, when they were employed at the church. Like usually they would like become choir boys. Yeah, they would become like choir boys who would sing at the church and stuff. But I'm not 100% sure how it was like done in Russia specifically. This is more like from my westernized music history knowledge, I guess. I hope that answered your question. By the way, I will likely this day list this stream until after the oral exam, just in case, because it would be a bit awkward if a lecturer, one of those that was actually gonna question, like test me, found this. So yeah. Why are neumes still used in the modern days? So in the case of the old believers, it's just because they're like really like their old traditions. I guess they're, let me put up this thing, the Wikipedia page for the old believers. I mean, I know their motivation behind sticking to the old beliefs. I guess they just really like the old stuff. I don't know. Maybe they think like, everything new sucks. You know, old people, I guess. But they're actually like the Graduale Romanum. Let me show you. I think this has... isn't there like one with that also uses neumes? I guess, yeah, there we go. That's the Graduale Romanum. That was Graduale Triplex. That's what it's called. Graduale Triplex. So we have the Graduale Triplex, which can still be in use today, which actually shows the like quadratic notation, which is like more commonly used. Usually for like old singing old church music, I believe following the Notre Dame tradition probably. So you would also have the rhythm, but you also have two different types of neumes here. One of them is the St. Gallen notation, and the other one I forgot. I guess as a side note, there were different kinds of neumes even in Western music. Like it wasn't like centralized, different regions had their own like variations of the neumes. So these are like two different types of neumes, one above, one below. And they actually, like I said, they indicate more clearly what the melody line actually looked like. Like it wasn't like this note and then drops up to this note exactly and then repeats this note exactly as well. It was more like wavy, I guess. Was more rough, like I showed in like that one picture, or I guess here's another picture. So you would have like these exact. Oh, actually, I'm not showing it. Dang it. Okay. Sorry about that. So now you can see it. Here's the like square notation. And then you have two different kinds of neumes, one above, one below. So they would use the square notation so that it's still like they still know which notes to hit roughly. But then they would still have these neumes. So they would actually they could represent this like wavy line more accurately using these neumes, because these neumes would be way better at representing how the melody line looked like, even if they didn't represent what notes exactly you had to sing. It was just a movement that was depicted with these neumes. And this movement just like is the drops or gets discarded when you just use this kind of notation. Let's hope I won't forget to actually switch the screen next time. Oh boy. Might as well look up what they. Hit me with your next question while I look up what neumes this actually features. So, St. Gallen. And Metzer. Okay, so these two types of neumes. When and why did people start transitioning to the modern music notation? So in Russian music, it was around the 17th century. It was because they wanted to depict, like I guess it was became more of a trend. Like Russia looked more to the West around that time, around the 17th century, at the end, especially at the end of the 17th century. Like, yeah, the problem was also that Russia didn't really have a proper like world music system. So they looked to the West because they had actually like world musician. I guess in the 17th century there would be people like Bach, for example. Like the first actual Russian world music musician was Glinka, who came about in the 18th century. So they didn't really have a similar person to look towards to, I guess. So this system that they then adapted from the Ukraine, or I guess not this exactly, the not the triplex, but this square notation, or how they called it, the Kiefer notation, because it came about in Kiev first. They adapted it because it was like more logical, I guess, and maybe trendy. Not 100% sure. I guess in the West, it actually came to be pretty much for the same reason, because people want to depict like the exact heights of the notes. And as opposed to Russia, they didn't really have these like signs that would be added to the neumes, so people would know which note they represented. Which, by the way, like these red signs, they weren't like uniform. Like in different regions, they also had like different kinds of signs, which also made things more like confusing. So maybe that was also a reason for adapting this style, because it was more like universal. So you wouldn't have like a different letter for the same note, because it was just like written in a different region. Like here, it was kind of like pretty clear what notes had to be sung. There was no ambiguity. So yeah, and this also was easier for, especially for multiple voices, where there were multiple voices playing along each other. So you could easily depict or easily make sure that they all hit the right notes and in the right rhythm. That was the reason why the Notre Dame notation was invented in the first place. Like this kind of notation where you have this like square notation where you would know exactly which notes had to be hit, and you had rhythm indications, rhythmical indications. I guess in this case, like we are used to the notes either being white or dang it. whites or whatever, they would have a point next to them. In this case, it was more like, I don't know the rules by heart, but there were rules like if it looks like this, then this node would be an exact, exactly that amount long, and that node would be exactly that amount long. So you could like figure out the length of the nodes from how they were connected. So yeah, I guess those were the main reasons, because like multiple voice singing became more popular in church music. Like I said, they also invented that, like the Kinovarne Pomieti in part, I believe, in part also because multiple voice singing became more popular, and they wanted to have like more exact indications which notes they had to sing and in what rhythm, so the notes, the singers would actually like sounds coherent, like so they wouldn't like randomly sing however they wanted to, but had exact indications on what note to sing when, which was pretty important for multiple voice singing. After hearing about the Russian neumes, is there anything that you realized that from the modern music notation is more supreme and could improve? Actually, I had a seminar last semester called the History of Music Encoding. Music Notation Encoding, I guess. And there was actually a pretty similar question there. Don't think I can remember the reply to that. But I guess if you were to ask if it would like adapt the Russian neumes in favor of what we have right now. I mean, personally, I mean, it does have that one weakness where it just shows like these exact note heights instead of showing the melody line properly. But I mean, you have stuff like in jazz music, the what are those called? The thingies that like the bends. Not bands. Stuff like this, like the quick fall, or the scoop, or the bend. Stuff like that, that kind of helps. Or here, you have this kind of notation that kind of substitutes the neumes notation. So, yeah, the neumes notation does have this advantage of like being able to portray this melody line. But I mean, you can kind of do it in the modern notation as well, in combination with like helping lines like these. So yeah, I personally, I'm not a fan. Like I wouldn't need to use the Russian neumes notation to notate anything. But I guess, like I would, if I had to draw a melody line that was more rough and not as like step-step-step-esque, I would just use these lines, these actual lines. But that's just for me personally. It's really like nice that it's more universal. I mean, there are like different notation styles and different like folk music thingies, like the shakuhachi notation, for example. But most musicians would get this. Like they would understand what this means, why they had to play, which might be more difficult with neumes notation because it was more rough. Would be less exact, I guess. Meaning there's like really modern notation, graphical notation maybe, which I wanted to do a presentation on as well someday, which looks like this. I mean, this trend came about in the, not this, this trend came about in the like 20th century. Especially when they thought like the notation right now wasn't sufficient. I mean, I guess you could adjust like neumes notation as well to make it like fit more your vision of music, like the way you want the music to be expressed. I guess modern notation is just like normalized. I guess that's the thing that's like I like about it. As opposed to neumes notation, which had like different variations in different regions. That's the problem. But it might just be a thing of like globalization. Like if times or like things were just as globalized back then as they are now, maybe they would have to normalize the neumes notation as well. But the Mongol invasion, how much does it impact that neumes? Does it slow it down or diversify it? I would say it probably diversifies it because, as mentioned, they were isolated from Byzantine around those times. So they couldn't like import stuff quite as easily and import notation. I'm actually not sure what notation Byzantine used after the equanating notation. I believe they... Okay, so that's what their neumes looked like later on. If that's not already the equanating notation. But yeah, I didn't really look into Byzantine notation, is the problem. But yeah, maybe if those Mongol invasions weren't around, maybe... they would have like adapted more of like the neumes even more from Byzantine, but then again, especially in like the Slavic region, the like urge for like doing their own thing was pretty like big because they wanted to solidify themselves as a nation. Like for example, let's take Bosnia, Croatia, and Serbia, for example. Like, most people say their languages are just a dialect from each other. Like, they're pretty much the same language, just a bit of a different dialect. But it's pretty important for them that they do see their language as their own, like, national language. Because in the Slavic region, specifically, having one's own language solidifies the nationality pretty like quite a lot for them. So I guess maybe it was the same with those neumes, because they thought like we need to have something like specifically Russian. We are going to make a new type of notation. Like we are going to make the Stolp notation or Kalkari notation. It could also have something to do with trends, like maybe they thought like, okay, we prefer this type of singing, and for like the equanating notation doesn't really work well with this type of singing, so we are going to invent the Stolp notation or the Kondakari notation, just like they invented the Puch notation for like multi voice singing, or the domestic notation for the kind of singing that is more complicated to sing and goes beyond the 8 tone system. I have to Google that one. What the heck? Ruler. Just a ruler. Okay, now we get it. Yeah, true. Though, there's a thing called that came about in the West that was like neumes on lines. I believe those came about in the 11th century. Let me look it up real quick. believe it was the 11th century. Let's see. Neumann here, okay. Yeah, in the 11th century, and then the 12th century. So you would have stuff like this, like neumes on actual lines. Like that was a like guess experiment in the West, where they also wanted to indicate like the actual heights more, so they started using, like to some degree started using neumes on lines as well. But the domestic notation, you said it's used for multiple pitch singing, pretty complex. The domestic notation was actually less used for multiple voice singing, because the signs were rather ambivalent. The Pooch notation was, I might have misspoken, Pooch notation was more more used for multiple voicing. It's written like this, by the way, domestic notation. I don't think there are any pictures of it here. Yeah, the last time I tried to Google it, I just got like math. And that's just the stop notation. So the thing is that the domestic notation, just like most of the other notation kinds, aside from the stop notation, are really under research. So it is mainly, I believe, a theory that was used for more complex music. I guess it was just associated with this specific type of singing. But I don't know too much about the history of domestic singing. Let's see. Oh, this actually sounds pretty interesting. The problem of Alt-Russian domestic singing. And before, this is like porn. Let me actually, just in case. Okay, no, we're safe. This might be worth looking into. What the heck? Okay, there's actually a thing here about the domestic singing. It's pretty interesting. But it looks kind of broken. Oh, there we go. I guess the pictures are just broken. But yeah, personally, not 100% sure. Like the source I looked at didn't really have much info on the domestic notation. Unfortunately. See, it does apparently have something to do with multiple voicing as well. So yeah, this is about already published material. Is this what it looked like? More sources. Decadence. What the heck is a decadence? Let's see. So just like died out. Yeah, maybe. I couldn't imagine that it was maybe used just in like specific regions. Actually, I should probably read this part later, just so I'm more prepared for my oral exam. But yeah, I can't fully answer that question, unfortunately. I'll just keep this around for later. Oh, I can't actually. Okay. Do you have any more questions before we get to music history? Oh, it's from 1967. Oh boy. How much do the church scale differ from the normal scales? I assume with the normal scales you mean like the major and minor scales that are popularized in like Western music. I'm not sure when they were invented. Guess we're already like around in ancient Greek. Or they were inspired by ancient Greek at the very least. Mean, yeah, they're kind of like ancient Greek-ish. So probably like, you know, like first century before Christ, pretty much. So church scales work like this, or modes, I guess, what you will call them. You have the major scale, which are, for example, all white keys from C to C. The Ionian modes, as you could say, but those weren't used in church music. And the minor mode would be from A, or minor scale would be from A to A. Like all the white keys, which is called the Aeolian, is it? The Aeolian mode, yeah, okay. There you go. Which would be the Aeolian mode, but like I said, the Aeolian mode was as well not used in like church music, just like the Ionian mode. And the Locrian mode wasn't either. Like that one was from B to B, with like white the white keys from B to B. I think it was more used, yeah, like in jazz music, I guess, but not really in church music. It sounds kind of weird, too. So yeah. So you had Phrygian, or Dorian, Phrygian, Lydian, and Mixolydian. So those were the four main modes, and then you had like Hippo Dorian, Hippo Phrygian, Hippo Lydian, Hippo Mixolydian. So eight modes in total. So you had like one like the normal modes, and then one what's it called? The plagal mode. Plagal mode, maybe. She does say here somewhere. Plagal. Yeah, plagals. So the authentic ones and the plagals. The authentic ones would be just like Dorian, Phrygian and so on, and the plagal ones would be Hippodorian, Hippophrygian, and so on. And it would signify a specific range, actually. So I don't know the range by heart, but Dorian, for example, would be, I don't know, I think it was like from C1, or like, I guess, lower C, to, I don't know, F or something. I'm just making things up. So, but just as an example, and the hypo variation of them would be lower, so it would have a lower range of notes that were used for this type of singing. Let me orient my hands properly. So you'd have the authentic modes that were higher in range, like they were further up on the like on the piano notes, so to speak. Like the singing range was higher. Then you had the hypo Dorian, for example, that were lower, that had like the board notes from like a lower area. So Dorian would be from D to G if you use all the white notes, or like on the D, like the D would be the main note, resting note. Phrygian would be the E, so the notes from E, all the white notes. Lydian would be from F, and Mixolydian would be from G, all the white notes. So those were the church modes that were used back then. And the modern ones are now the like major, also called the Aeolian mode, and the minor, also called the Aeolian mode. So yeah. I mean, people still use those modes in part, like the Dorian modes. I think someone mentioned that it's like pretty nice for RPG, heroic, adventurous music. So yeah, it's not like those modes were only used back then. They're also used now, but the major scale and the minor scale are way more common. While back then, in church music, they weren't used at all. They only used like Dorian, Phrygian, Lydian, Mixolydian, and all their like Plagal variants, which had a like lower range. I hope I was able to kind of explain it properly. So apparently they had also stuff like low Mixolydian or hyper Dorian. But I guess it wasn't really a thing in the Middle Ages, probably. It sounds more like yeah, Greek modes, which inspired the Western church modes. And also, like I said, Russia used these modes as well. Russian church music with the stop notation. Oh boy. I guess, I assume that's it for questions. Let me know if you have any more. And if you don't, let's practice real quick random music history stuff. I mean, this is to some degree already asking about music history because of like branch out into modes. I guess, and what else? Like overall music notation, including Western music notation. So this already like included like overall music history questions. Feel free to ask me questions about more modern music as well. Like, you can just give me a century, so we'll try to talk about it for a bit. Did the Romans have music notation? I mean, they pretty much did use the standard neumes back then. I think there's a Roman neumen stuff. Let me actually... Is there like a list? I have a thing somewhere where they're like... notation stuff there. Let's see, I think they're just... Actually, they even say that... people say that the neumen were invented in the Roman Empire. So yeah, they... Like, pretty much all of Western Europe did use neume notation. Though, I think... I'm not sure who started using... square note notation. What's it called properly? There's actually no English page for quadrat notation. So, I mean, it came about pretty early, like in the 11th century already. Apparently. Actually, this was like with the lines. She doesn't properly say when it came about. Let me look at my spreadsheet. No, they actually were about in the 11th century. So this kind of notation was already around in the 11th century. So Guido von Reitzau apparently did kind of invent it, even though it says here that it was just attributed to him starting to put neumes on lines. It's not fully clear. Like, this page is kind of Oh, here we go, 12th century. Become more standardized. But I believe Guido von Arezzo already like mentioned this kind of notation in the 11th century, but it became more popular in the 12th century. So yeah, some apparently also used this kind of notation, this notation. So neumes also put in poems back in the day. I'm not quite sure what this means. You might have to clarify the question again. Like, did they sing poems using neumes? I think is what you mean. Like, not just church music and holy text, but also like worldly music, I assume. Actually, regarding world music, the thing is that the world music didn't really have a proper notation for the longest time. And like Russian music, like in Russia, world music was prohibited for really long periods of time. So there was just an oral tradition. So yeah, to the 17th century when they also started using this kind of notation for Russian world music. People use neumes in poems. Oh, I see. So you mean like people write poems and then add neumes so that people know how to read it? Is that what you mean? I believe probably not. I'm not aware of a case where that was like where neumes was were used for poems, for not sung, like for things where things weren't sung for accentuation. Like there's of course that one case in like Russian church music where ekphonetic notation was used by or for lectors who but they still sang the text. Like it wasn't for singers specifically, but for lectors, but they still sang the text. So I guess the answer would be probably not. So yeah, that's my answer. Time to hydrate. Oh boy. Really hoping that I have a like really rough grasp on that history. As an interesting side note, since I have while you're waiting for more questions. Since I mentioned the Kinowarne Pomieti, these red like letters in Russian church music that were invented in the 17th century by Ivan Schaidur. There was actually something similar in Western music as well. The literae significativi that came about in the 12th century, I believe. So you would have like letters next to neumes as well, and they wouldn't like indicate specific like notes as they would in like as they did in the Russian church music. They wouldn't say, okay, this note is a, I don't know, B or something like that. It would just be like really rough stuff, like here, A, which would stand for, could stand for altius, which would mean just higher, so it would go up at that part, or E for equaliter, so it would just stay on the same note, or C for celeriter, which would just mean faster or fast, so it would sing that part fast. I believe it was the 12th century. Let me look it up real quick. Was it the 11th? I know, it wasn't quite sure. Okay. Maybe around the 11th century. But I'm not 100% sure. If you don't have any Neumann question, give me a century and I will try my best to talk about centuries. Do most countries start with neumes for singing? Nope. Just more of a Western tradition. And I mean, Byzantine used neumes as well, so which was like Byzantine was also a big hub, like church, big thing. So, like this part of the world, like the west, more western part, including the like oriental part that was closer to Europe, used neumes. But actually, I would be really interested in knowing what like monks in, for example, I don't know, China used. Chinese notation. I guess that's what the Chinese notation looked like. Actually, this looks pretty much just like the notation that is also used for shakuhachi. So yeah, neumes are more of a Western thing, I believe. I don't think they really used neumes in Eastern music. Yeah, I know this kind of notation was used for instrumental music specifically, like shakuhachi notation. Was it? Maybe it wasn't. I thought shakuhachi notation was that, with the thingies. With the numbers, but I guess not. How much different in the head is Russian neumes compared to other neumes? I would say, I mean, I think one thing it had that other neumes didn't necessarily have is, like I mentioned, the thing, at least the stop notation, had exact indications on how long the notes were. Like I showed in that one thing here, I think it's here as well. Like here, you would know exactly how long the note would be, so that's an advantage. And they did add those red signs later on that I showed over here. Would actually tell you what the exact notes were that you were supposed to sing, which Western neumes, well, didn't quite have. Like I said, that those literary significativi, but those were just for like rough indications on how to sing things, not what notes to hit exactly. But I mean, they had like Western notation had these the exact pitch indications way earlier than Russia. Like, this came about in the 17th century, the beginning of the 17th century, beginning to middle. While in the West, the quadratic notation was already in use in the like 12th century, for example, became even more elaborate in the 13th century. Like, in the 13th century, people, they already had like the system of, you knew what notes to sing and you knew how long those notes were already during the Notre Dame epoch. So you had pretty much this system already 300, 400 years before that, before them, while Russian singing was still kind of rough, pretty much. Well, like, the Russian neumes kind of feels like they were a few centuries behind compared to like the innovations in the Western church music. So that's the thing. So while these neumes eventually did have exact pitch indications, they had them at a point where the Western music didn't even need them anymore. Guess that's the thing. Or, well, used other means, I guess, in combination with these neumes. Like, they, like I showed the triplex Romanum. Was it Quadrale triplex? They still use this notation combined with the neumes to show a more like proper representation of the melody line. I feel like you're a neumes expert now, Alfred. The Western creators are now called modern notation. Pretty much, I mean, they use the Italian notation. Maybe I can find it like this. So yeah, pretty much they came about because of like this. They started using this kind of notation eventually with the like white notats, and I believe it's called the modal notation, trecento notation. Oh wait, it wasn't trecento notation. Trecento notation is it? Well, kind of, I guess. I mean, the trecento notation kind of led slowly. And then there came this. And so it slowly developed into, you know, our modern notation. Like, this is mensural notation, is what it's called. So yeah, this came to be in the like in Italy, or like the first attempts were on Italy, and it like spread from like Europe eventually to around the world. So yeah, the legacy is Western. Is modern notation still changing? Let me go back to the graphic notation. I mean, these are some extremes, obviously. Because like some people do believe that, especially for modern music, the like our notation isn't enough for like contemporary classical music. I like this one. Anyhow, so they invent things like these, because this would be like a more accurate way to describe their like vision of their music. But I mean, we are right now pretty like dominated by 18th century music theory. like 17th, 18th century music history. So most people still stick to the like to those like norms, but I've shown like stuff like the bends. I'm not sure when these came to be, but they weren't really around in like the classical era, I believe. A smear and stuff. Like there are things that are they came about later. So new things do get added, and I mean there are of course like things that are more like commonly accepted, like these jazz notations, jazz articulations. They're more used like in like jazz music, for example, and then there are like those like extremes that are more individual for those specific pieces. Isn't harder to read if you make it look so jumbly. Well, one thing about graphical notation is oftentimes that, I mean, there are like two branches of contemporary music. There's one where you do things like to make it, like the notation reflect exactly what you want. So you're like hyper exact. Not sure if I can find an example. But things where you say like, okay, and here, exactly for here, you need to breathe for exactly 0.5 seconds. Then you play this note for exactly 1 second and, I don't know, 3 seconds. And then exactly at this point, you do exactly this. So there's this school of thought, or like this way of expressing one's music. Then there's stuff like, which is, I guess, more like this, where you're more like, okay, this is like kind of roughly you yourself, you the musician need to interpret it. Like you need to figure out yourself what this means, what these lines mean, how you need to perform this, with which instruments you need to perform this, stuff like this. Is it because of jazz stuff, or what's the motive to make new changes to it? Yeah, I guess specific jazz, like the way they express jazz. Let's go back to jazz bands. Like stuff like Glissando was around for quite a while, obviously. But things like the, like these scoops and bends and stuff, these are like things that are pretty common in jazz. So you would have like extra notational devices invented for that specific style because it was so common there. So eventually people started using like stuff like this for the bend. And actually, what the heck? Is this a bend on a piano? How do you do a bend on a piano? Okay. So yeah, you have stuff like this because a new musical style needs them. So new ways to notate that become like more commonplace. I mean, bends on a piano sounds pretty cool. Gradient tone like this. So yeah, I believe they invented quite a few notational stuff in like the 19th century as well, because they like tried out new stuff in the 19th century. Like the 19th century was like the time when people were like, invention was a thing, like always. Like if you go back to the 17th century, end of the 16th century, where someone was like, hey dude, Monteverdi, I think it was Monteverdi, yeah, Monteverdi, your piece sucks because it breaks this law of music. And then Monteverdi was like, dude, shut the fuck up. I am an inventor. What I am doing is the seconda practica. What you are doing is the prima practica. The seconda practica is the new way to do music. So I made this thing that you call mistake on purpose. Get wrecked. So stuff like that. And then in the 19th century, you had like people discarding the tonal center more and more. Like usually it was the norm to start on the like main chord note. It truly was a Chad move. Monteverdi was a Chad. So in the 19th century, or before 19th century, usually people would start on the like the main chord. So if you had a piece in C major, the first chord would be a C major. If you had a piece in A minor, the first chord would be an A minor. But then came the Romantic era, the 19th century, and people started using stuff like the dominant. So in the G major, even though the scale was C major. Like at the very beginning, stuff like that. So yeah, and then it got more and more extreme until the 20th century, where we got atonal music, where people were like, screw tonality. We don't need tonality. We make wacky sounding music using all notes on the piano. Even the black ones, even though we would be all the black and all the white keys, pretty much. Let me actually show you atonality in case you haven't heard of it before. Please, YouTube. Give me some of that old atonal music. What the heck? Actually, maybe this one would be a nice example. Black MIDI stuff. I mean, I guess to some degree. Okay, here we go. What is this? Schönberg. Yeah, Schönberg, the one that like started this in the first place. You think I'll get copyright stricken for atonal music? Oh yeah, I said I didn't want to. I wasn't going to play YouTube videos, and here I am playing YouTube videos, cutting your ears. Actually, you can't even hear it. Just realized. Yeah, I guess you got lucky. I will turn the volume down. And now let me see. Okay, now you should be able to hear it. There you go. I think that's enough. So yeah, actually, on the note of microtonality, I think what's interesting about it is like microtonality was used especially in folk music for quite a long time, actually. Let me get a book. Give me 1 second. I got a book. So we have a few transcription attempts here. Let's see if I can find it. Find a good example. This is a book on folk music instruments and instrumental folk music in Russia. But also, I believe, has some songs. Actually, hey, I found a band. Let me go to the webcam. Here, I found a band. So, I guess Russia did jazz before jazz did it. But no, actually, what's happening here is that they just use like jazz signs to express something that's well, they don't really didn't really have other signs for. I can't properly find a good example. I thought this had some good ones of like microtonality. I guess this is, yeah, maybe this. So they're using like let me figure this out. Okay, there we go. So you see these arrows. And these arrows indicate like microtonal shifts, like up here. There we go. Microtonal shifts. And microtonality was especially also used a lot in like Arabic music. Arabic music use microtonality a lot. I think it's pretty interesting that contemporary classical music has shifts to use microtonality as well. Like there's actually like scales, Arabic scales that are built on microtonality. 50 cents, let me make sure. I'm finding the rapper 50 Cent. It's 50 Cent, half a half note. Give me a second. Okay, I'm not sure how much 50 cent are exactly. But I mean, I think, yeah, if you mean like the interval between like two, like one half tone, then yeah. And yeah, I agree. I mean, it's like kind of odd, kind of an odd thing. Like we came to learn, like we just got used to the 12 tone scale, even though, like, yeah, as I said, like Arabic music is really built on like notes that are in between. Half a dollar. usually I see these signs actually used for microtonality. Okay, yeah. I guess I'm not too used to thinking in cents, I have to admit. So yeah, usually I'm used to seeing like stuff like this for microtonality. Actually, one thing, while we are on atonal music, and since you are a fan of atonal music, there are actually like 3 steps to atonal music. Like atonal music started with Schoenberg in the 20th century, I believe. that's an N, even though it should be an M. No, Arnold Schoenberg. Okay. When did he start with atonal music? Yeah, I guess it was the 20th century. Yeah, here we go. So he started like doing atonal music stuff. It was also called the second Vienna school, music school, I guess. Let's see if there's a proper translation. Second Vienna school, which was about atonality. And there were pretty much three steps to it. There was at first just atonal music, free atonality is what it was called. It's called freie Atonalität. It's a German word for it. Free encyclopedia. Well, the direct translation is free atonality, which was just like play whatever you want, whoever you want. Then you have 12-tone music, which came about a bit later, which meant that each note could only be repeated like once until all 12 tones were played at least once. So if you had a C at the beginning, you couldn't play that C until all of the other 12 tones or 11 tones were played. So you had to play C sharp, D, D sharp, and so on once until you could repeat C again. And same for like, if the second note was C sharp, then you had to wait again until all of the other notes were played until you could again play C sharp. Like you had this 12 tone sequence. And this 12 tone sequence could be varied. Like here, for example, like prime would be the original. Yeah, like fighting game combos. Then you have it in reverse. Then you have it in inverse. Like reverse would just mean you would put it like backwards. You would play it backwards. Inverse would mean that instead of playing up, you play down. Retrograde inverse would mean that you play reverse and you play like up instead of down. So these were like some ways to vary this 12-tone sequence that people would make. And then you had the next step, serial 12-tone serialism. This is like a step up. Like before, you had like just the note heights, like the pitch that was like put in sequence, but now you had other features put in sequence as well. Like for example, the note lengths, like here. Or articulation. Like you would have a sequence of articulation stuff, like when to accentuate, when to play a legato, when to play a staccato, meaning like when to play a lot long, when to play it short. Or even stuff like dynamics, meaning like the volume. Like you would have a sequence like piano, then forte piano, and so on. Let's see if we can find a good... good example. I guess this apparently is... serial music. Nice ad. I thought you would show some examples. Guess let's look at this one. Okay, so here's the sequence. This is a toned row. It doesn't seem to have any like articulation rows, unfortunately. Maybe over here. It doesn't seem like it. Let me play it to you, nevertheless, in case you're curious. Actually, let's fast forward. Thank you. So this was all about innovation, discarding the tonal center, discarding tonality. But there was also actually a counter movement of people wanting to compose in the old style. There were actually people that composed pieces that were more like in the style of the Middle Ages, for example. So this is kind of the extreme opposite. People wanting to do old stuff instead of wanting to invent all new stuff. Actually, expressionistic music is pretty interesting, in my opinion. Is this one expressionistic music? It's like post-war music, like wanted to show the chaotic nature of war and the bustle of the city, like the chaotic times, pretty much. So it was pretty chaotic. I mean, this isn't quite the right one, because the thing about expressionistic music is also that it's really loud. I guess I won't be able to find a really good example. I guess maybe this is more like it. This is a bit like comedic music. I feel like Joe Hisaishi's score from Spirited Away soundtrack. I'll definitely get copyright stricken for this. Not this. I think it was this one, maybe. Oops. Clicked on the ad. In fact, Joe Hisaishi sometimes borrows from expressionistic music. So yeah. Talking about the Vienna School, like, I've talked about the second Vienna School. What about the first Vienna School? What happened to the first Vienna School? Why? And where? And how? Actually, the first Vienna School, just like pretty interesting, I think. Let me make sure that this it's actually what I think it is. First Vienna School. I think that was. Yeah, it's just the Vienna Classic. So the. Classical period, pretty much, which is considered the classical period, but nowadays people, when they say classical music, they mean just music from the, oftentimes from the 19th, 18th, and 17th century, and 16th maybe, some degree. There's no third Vienna School, unfortunately. Maybe one day there will be. So the thing is about the first Vienna School, or the actual, like, the Vienna School, is that it centers around people, like three people mainly, like Mozart, Handel, I guess is the English pronunciation. Mozart, Handel, and one more. Beethoven, right, those three. Those three are the main artists from the Vienna School. And the thing is that they all lived in Vienna. And they really dominated the Western European music world pretty heavily. So that's why it's called the Vienna School, because they were all in the same place. Even though they did have some differences, so this term is kind of problematic, because it ignores people from outside of the Viennese, like outside of Vienna. It was like Schumann, maybe. I'm not sure. but it ignores people outside of Vienna. And there are still differences in their musical styles, like between Mozart, Handel, and Beethoven. So it's kind of weird to like say that this was like a common like era of music, because they did also have micro differences between them, or maybe even some major. And they lived during different times as well. I mean, Beethoven lived quite longer. Like his later works were already in the like Romantic era, so he like peaked into the Romantic era already, even though he was like he's regarded as a classical musician. I mean, these like it's actually the proper English word. Epoch, maybe. Let's see if I can find English translation. There's no translation. I guess epochs. Epochs in general are kind of problematic, of course, because the problem is that, like, where do they really start and where do they really end? Because, like, I mentioned Monteverdi, who like started using the Seconda Practica. So people say like the Seconda Practica, like people like focus on more on effect, meaning like the expression of feelings, rather than actual like these concepts of like musical theoretical concepts, like saying I will break this rule because it will make the like feeling like it will make people feel things, and this is more important for me. Like people still stuck to the Prima Practica to some degree. Like people didn't just go, oh yeah, Monteverdi, he's a Chad, I will now do everything exactly like Monteverdi and will disregard everything that happened before. So while the Seconda Practica was a thing of the like Baroque era, people didn't, like, not all people just suddenly started doing the Seconda Practica thing and just only focusing on expressing emotion through music instead of like doing like exact musical theoretical stuff following Palestrina style, a counterpoint and all that stuff. So and another thing is, where do it does it start properly? Like, there's a there's a transition, like just like at in 1600, exactly 1600 on 1st of January, people didn't just like weren't like, oh yeah, time to do the monodic singing. Monodic singing being like there's like one main voice and just accordic accompaniment instead of like multiple voices singing against each other with their own melody lines, which was more like the trend in the 16th century. There was like a switch that was flipped. It's like a transitional period. Usually people set like the death date of artists or like prominent composers as the like end of a century or the end of an epoch, musical epoch. But yeah, overall, it's pretty problematic because people didn't just start doing everything different from a point forward, and there's like a transitional period. And I mean, people nowadays still like also make more romantic oriented music, for example, even though this epoch would be called like contemporary music epoch in art music at the very least. So people doing like stuff like atonality and such, and experimenting with music even more, or trying to bring music to its like trying to break the boundaries of that are set for music. And there are still people who stick to the boundaries and make music that's more like romantic or classical oriented. And I agree, the feeling of Chadness, the Chad Sonata. Actually, one interesting thing while I'm talking about random music stuff about sonatas like I ranted about genre, and I like ranting about genre because genres don't make sense oftentimes. Like you would have one genre term, but then it would be really vague, and it was only would be only meant for marketing, for example. And then you would have multiple genre terms for the same thing, stuff like that. And I think I've mentioned it before, but that's been like a thing for a really long time, like back then in the like 16th century, I think. Let me look up when sonatas become a thing. Yeah, 16th century. I guess 16th, 17th century. Which just meant a piece for instrumentals. Like an instrumental piece. And then you had as a like opposite thing, a cantata. Which was like for singing. But then you had the problem that people started intabulating, meaning they transcribed vocal pieces like cantatas for instruments, like a lute, for example. And they would still leave the title cantata over it because it was just an intabulation, but it was now an instrumental piece. So you had instrumental pieces called cantata, even though cantata means a piece for singers. Really weird stuff. It feels like today is the highest point of experimentation so far, but who knows? It kind of does feel like it. Like because you have like people going really crazy different directions, playing with sound pretty heavily. I guess it's a bit of a difficult topic. Because I mean, back then you also had innovation. Like I said, that one guy being a chat. Or in the Romantic era, people being like, okay, I'll use like forte fortissimo, and I'll start my piece with a dominant chord instead of the tonic, being like G major and C major instead of with a C major chord. But it does feel like things are getting really crazy right now, because there are so many people trying out different things. Actually, just one pretty interesting concert format, like also including concert formats, like when you might have heard of the disaster concerts, like there was Gesang der Jünglinge, I think it's called. Gesang der Jünglinge, was it that? Yeah, Gesang der Jünglinge by Stockhausen. So, and it was, I think, a disaster concert. See, disaster, was it? Concert. I don't know. Either way, people didn't like it. The thing is, it was around the time when people started recording stuff. So, and there were like tape music and stuff like that where people would, let me actually turn off desktop audio so I don't hear my USB stuff unplugging all the time. So people would like record stuff and then warp it, do different stuff with it, reverse it. Make like a bit beat out of it. I guess it's a precursor of electronic dance music. So people started doing stuff with recordings. And Stockhausen made a piece called Gesang der Jünglinge. And since it was like dependent on recordings, there was no like real-time manipulation in his case. So what they did, they put a speaker on the like in the concert hall. And people were like, what the fuck? I want to see the actual musicians. I don't want to hear like a recording. I'm here to hear like an actual like an actual concert, like an actual live concert instead of a recording. And so they really hated it because he put a speaker on the like there in front of them instead of like actual musicians. So yeah, that was pretty interesting. I mean, you have like other stuff like Cage, I think. Cage is 33. year 433 actually. I could imagine people getting upset at that as well, because it was like not actual like music. So 433 is pretty like famous. You might have heard of it. Just someone sitting down at the piano. And then they open it up, like they open the like lid of the piano, and then they sit there for like some time. Like it has three movements. After each movement, they close the lid and open it again, but they don't play anything. They just sit there, just all the pieces. And so actually there's a metal cover. Metal cover. Let me show it to you. Yeah, this one. This is really cool. Death metal cover. Let me actually turn the sound so you can hear nothing. So this was the intro. Okay, here we go. I like the guy going woo. So this was just the intro. Now 4:33 actually just started. It stands for 4 minutes and 33 seconds, by the way. And now they just stand there. Yeah, that's the piece. The thing is, what this is about is... it's not like you don't hear anything while you're in that concert hall. Like, just because that guy isn't playing anything, you still hear stuff like people shuffling around, or like someone coughing, or... I don't know. Someone saying, what the fuck is this? And this is all part of the performance. Like, what you're actually hearing in that concert is everything around you. Like, the audience. Like, the audience is the music, pretty much. Like people shuffling with their feet, all of that is part of the audio experience. Like that's the goal behind John Cage's 4:33. I like how he just randomly used the pedal. They just randomly use pedals to switch between like different settings on a guitar, but they're not playing anything. The ambient music is pretty interesting as well. Kind of became a fan of Brian Eno, I think, because of Yume Nikki. Brian Eno was one of the like main big people for like ambient music. They made music for airports, I think. Yeah, music for airports, ambient one, music for airports. So yeah, this I can recommend listening to it. I think it's really cool. It's just ambient music, just really chill. And I've actually read like an article on like how to like learn better, like how to induce better learning with and one of the examples was, of course, listening to classical music, calm classical music. It's like the stereotypical one. So if you listen to calm classical music while learning, that info stays in your head better, more easily. Or as an alternative, as a modern alternative, they actually suggested ambient music, like Music for Airports by Brian Eno. If you are some psychological music, The Waste of Silence, people would make. It's actually pretty interesting. Because there's psychological music. Serious psychological horror music. But yeah, it's like pretty cool to, I mean, what I like about contemporary music I like it in a shitposty way. I mean, it's not like meant as a negative way, of course. I mean, you could see it as a negative, as me being negative about contemporary music. But I think listening to contemporary music is way less fun than making it, for me personally. So I would be like, it would be really fun to make like really out of there, like really experimental music, but I wouldn't want to listen to it. And I mean, there's some comical value to some contemporary music, like the Cardboard Quartet. What is the quartet? Yeah, Cardboard Quartet number 3, for example. Which is them just, I mean, the whole sense behind it is this, like, them pretending to be like a group of really poor musicians who don't even have instruments, so they play on cardboard. So that's the whole thing behind the Cardboard Quartet. It's music from hell. Can you actually see the screen? For some reason it doesn't show the screen on my preview. Don't think you can actually see the video, can you? No, you can't. Okay, for some reason it doesn't want to show it. Okay, I guess I have to go into full screen. This is what poverty sounds like. I think the funniest part is when that guy just starts doing random stuff. like this. Yeah, why did he punch himself? Why did he do this? And then he starts rolling around. I really like that one. Like, he just disappears for a bit. Like, and then there he is. Like, the camera pans over. There he is. Rolling around on paper. I mean, this is a really eccentric way of making music. And I mean, like, contemporary music is all about giving you new experiences. So, I mean, this is definitely a new experience. I mean, I wouldn't listen to it in my free time, but this isn't necessarily what this is about, I guess. Yeah, it is a show to give you new experiences. Oh, there's actually a cat. Cat concert. Meow. I think, is it just called Meow? Is it Meow? So it's people just singing Meow. What does the fox say? Oh no. So yeah, stuff like that. Interesting stuff. Yeah, that's Barossini. So yeah, that's a cat duet. Barossini. Rossini, if it wasn't he like 19th century? When did Rossini live? Yeah, 19th century. So even in the 19th century they did like, I mean, entertaining stuff like that. Oh boy. My cat when the ball is only 75% full of cat food. This is pretty accurate, I would say. Pretty accurate. Oh boy. So yeah, that's that. I think I've streamed for almost 2.5 hours. I think it's time to probably finish this. So, I mean, we have talked about like a big range of music history. So this is a, I think this was a pretty good preparation for the oral exam on Wednesday. Wish me luck. I mean, it's not really a big deal because the thing is, even if I get a pretty bad grade in my oral exam, I still be able to study the master's. Like, you do need a specific grade at the very least. Like I believe at 2.4. But my other like my papers were pretty good, so I'm not really too worried. Thanks. I will do my best for you, June and Alfred. I will tell them all about the chadness of I actually forgot his name. This is a bad sign. The badness of Monteverdi, the chadness of Monteverdi. Oh God, what's up with my hair? Actually, my hair was so long. At some point, I could do make like a emo thing. Like I would just put it over my eye. Okay. So yeah, I will see you around. Maybe another stream someday. I guess the thing is that I have a lot of things to do for university starting since it's starting up again in 2 weeks. But yeah. I'll see you around. Goodbye. She isn't doing anything.
No.
Oh no, not this.
Change the world. My final message. Goodbye.